My name is Yvette Larson. She is Sunt Fundator al Bucharest Lounge. And I'm on a very, very steep learning curve with learning Romanian. So I thought that it's better that I stick to English today. But having said that, I look forward to the day when I can read Eminescu or the other ones in Romanian, but I'm not there yet. So this will be in English. And I'm gonna talk about the Bucharest Lounge today, but before I do this, I would like you to travel back in time with me, because the Bucharest Lounge didn't happen just like this. Something happened quite some time ago. So before we get to the Bucharest Lounge, come with me to 1989, and I'm gonna read something that I wrote when I was 17 years old. And I wrote it to my pen friend that I got when I was 13 years old. So here we go, November 1989. Did you know that East Germany is open for travels now? Berlin is not a two-parted town any longer. Have you heard about Hungary and Poland? This is something I wrote to Mihai. And in December, he is calling my mom, and he says this. This is December 1989, early December. You have to tell Yvette not to write about those things. Can you hear me? She can absolutely not write about politics. Tell her that she must not, under any circumstances, write to the president. It's dangerous for me. The police came to visit me at my home. They were asking me why I am in contact with somebody in Sweden. Somebody who speaks negatively about Romania. That was me. Ah, we don't know where people go when the police come and pick us up in the middle of the night. Tell her I'm young and I'm a little bit scared. So, as I said, my journey or my relationship with Romania started very early in life. I was only 13 years old when I was here the first time. In Mamaia, in 1985, this is me, and it's my mom and my grandparents. So this is where it all started. And I got a pen friend from here, and we started to write to each other. And we wrote for 18 years. We wrote real letters. Now stop for a moment and think about real letters. They are eternal. They don't escape into cyberspace. They are artifacts. They are part of our culture and they are part of history. They are like a fingerprint. This is just a small parenthesis. So this friendship made me have Romania under my scan my whole life. So I was following what was going on here. And there were some teachers that were wondering why I was writing essays about Romania, about freedom of speech, about democracy at the age of 13 or 14, because I was influenced what I had met here. However, I didn't come back here until 26 years after. That was in 2011. I had a passion for people, for places, and for traveling. So I went to live as an expat for 13 years. And why I'm saying this is because I know what it's like being somewhere else. This is not my country. And I know what it is to learn a new language. I know what it is to meet stereotypical views. Having said this, as a Swede, it's easy for me. I never had problems going to a border control. I never had problems at all when I say I'm a Swede. So let's stay with this, and we will come back to this. In 2011, 26 years after my first visit to Romania, that's actually a whole generation ago, I came back to Romania. I arrived in Bucharest, and there was something that struck me this first time. I was thinking, wow. I was at this stage, wow. I was thinking, the Romanians are friendly, they are hospitable, the country is beautiful, I was traveling around, everything is here, there are amazing mountains, there is the sea, there is a funky, dynamic urban capital, a European capital that, who knows about Bucharest? there is a cultural heritage here. I have this pendant on me because it's, maybe you recognize it from short distance, the Nicolae Gheorghescu. And I was thinking, there is so much potential here. Why do we only see the bad things from Romania? Because that's a fact. Well, that's the image that we have outside the country's border. So I started to think, why? And I also thought that this discrepancy, what was here and what we see outside the country's border, is so huge. And then I thought, when I came home, I started to do some lobbying. I went on to all those Facebook pages that deals with tourism or with graphic designs or artists, and I started to lobby and I said, please, write about your things in English too. We can use English as a tool of communication, as I am doing now. English is not my mother tongue. It's a language I learned in school. We use English as a mean of communication to reach out. And I said, for Facebook, for example, I said, write one thing in Romanian and one thing in English, and we include a lot of people. And it was going sort of not as I hoped. And then I thought, maybe I should do it myself. Maybe I should start to try and rebrand Romania. Because I had so many of my friends, they were asking me a little bit suspiciously, like, what is it that you do in Romania? Why are you there? Why are you so enthusiastic about it? And I sort of got fed up with this. And I thought, okay, I will set up a blog and I will just post loads of pictures. Because the world we live in now, we are consuming pictures every day through social media, Facebook, Pinterest, Instagram. We spend a lot of time looking at pictures. So I thought, okay, that's also a tool of communication. And then at the same time, I also set up an initiative where we support a village in Prahova. And we were doing a big collection of donations for them. And as this was a private initiative, I felt the need for a tool to communicate with the people who donated things. The initiative is called One Item, because everybody has one item to give. So those two together made me start the blog, the Bucharest Lounge. And the blog, I chose the name very consciously. I chose the name Bucharest, not Romania, because I wanted to put Bucharest as a city, as a capital, as a European capital on the map. So this was the reason why. And then I chose lounge, because I thought, in a lounge, we sit together with friends or colleagues, we relax, we have a coffee or we drink something, it's a nice place to be. And when we are relaxed, those great ideas can flourish. There is space. We are not stressed. So we can discuss things and we can make things happen. So that's why I choose the name the Bucharest Lounge. And I also wanted to have a Romanian graphic designer doing the logotype because I wanted to incorporate this. So I had a young, talented Romanian doing the logotype for me. So that is a little bit behind how I was thinking. Now, what is the Bucharest Lounge? It's a place where I share the beauty and the meaning coming from Bucharest, not only from Bucharest, but actually the whole of Romania. And I do it from the viewpoint of a Swede, through the eyes of a Swede. So with all this that I'm going to talk about today, I say this humbly, because I'm not here. I don't create this through here. I am creating this from abroad, from the one who is looking inside. So I don't sit with all the answers. I just sit with my perspective. And I see a lot of good things going on here. And I see how things are growing from inside. So with the Bucharest Lounge, I set up a few purposes. Because I also have my normal job. People think that the Bucharest Lounge is a company. And some people come and ask for fundings. And I say, I'm a mom. I have two children. I work as a teacher. this is something I do because of my passion and because of my belief. I cannot not do this. So the takeaway from this is that when we do things from the passion, from the drive inside, things happen. All the rest will follow. This is your drive. I have people asking me, so I want to help you. I want to do this. I have those kinds of emails coming every day. And then I just turn the question to them. Okay, that's great. But what is it that you would like to help with? What is your passion? What is your drive? Because I don't want to be the one who tells you should go and do this. The things that comes from your own drive is the things that will flourish, that will make things happen, and that will change things as well. So, beauty and meaning from Romania. Somebody asked me as well, but it's not like pink and fluffy and, you know, it's not all positive. Why don't you write about the other things? And this is my answer to that. We all know about the challenges. We all know about struggle. So I figured I don't live here. I don't follow every day what is going on in this country. I cannot have a dialogue every day about politics, for example. If I could, if I would be here, maybe I would, maybe I wouldn't. But for me, I chose consciously to show the beauty and the meaning from here, from Bucharest and from Romania. Because I believe also that when we show the good examples or the good role models, others will be inspired. For example, on Thursdays, I have the Thursday interview. When I see somebody who exceed in their field, it can be anything. It can be a teacher, it can be the man in the bakery, it can be a scientist or a musician or from all walks of life. When I stumble upon those people, I interview them and I put them like, look, these people are doing great in their field. You can do it too. So we come back to this. When you do something from your passion, others, they can also step up and follow. So that's what I do on the Thursdays. So the purposes, I have three purposes with the Bucharest Lounge. Two of them I set myself in December last year. And the third one sort of grew from itself. It was, you know, you can plan for a lot of things, but there are also something magic in life that you cannot plan for. So the third purpose was, I will come back to this. The first purpose is to rebrand, to market. This sounds maybe a little bit commercial, but it's not. To rebrand, market, and invite people back here. Because when I was a teenager, people from Scandinavia, they came traveling here and they wanted to come and visit Romania. When I say rebrand, I would like to change the stereotypical views and image about Bucharest and Romania. There are two things. Either people don't know anything, or the image is sort of painted in gray and brown and very dark. I want to show them that there is a more nuanced picture. There is full of color here. And I also would like to put Bucharest on the map. When we talk about Bucharest as a city, I am sort of fed up listening to this, Bucharest is the little Paris, and we show the Arc de Triomphe. I would like to see ad campaigns, I would like to see tourist campaigns, I would like to see more of what is the essence of Bucharest, instead of saying Bucharest is the little Paris, or comparing it to something else. I would like to see that the identity of Bucharest as a city and the identity of Romania as a country. What is it? What is the essence there? And then communicate it to the world. And that's not an easy task because there are lots of soul-seeking, as I see it here. When I come to Bucharest, there are two things that are going on for me. One thing is an urban, vibrant, eclectic town that has a lot of landmarks, that has a long history, that has colorful culture and folklore. There is a lot of things going on here. beautiful architecture, the mix. The mix for me is what is making Bucharest this vibrant town as it is. There is also, that was the urban part, there is also the flavor of the village life. Sometimes I see this coming in Bucharest as well, with the values, with the strong values, as I see, I cannot touch it, but it's something about the soul of the people who lives in Romania. It's also brought into Bucharest. You have to see it. You have to be open to see it. So when I was talking, I'm always asking people, so what is the identity of Bucharest? What is the essence? Think about it for a moment. What is it that makes this town so special? For me, it's the people who lives here, and it's passion in this town. It's I sometimes say to my friends in Sweden, even if I'm in Sweden, I can feel the heartbeat of Bucharest. This is what Bucharest is for me. So the second purpose of the Bucharest Lounge is to model a positive leadership, to be a constant optimistic voice. And I've been challenged by this, not on a daily basis, but every now and again. And this has to do with endurance, and it has to do with dedication. Because if we want to change things, we have to be enduring, and we have to be dedicated. And we always have to stick to the things that are important to us. So that is the second purpose. And the third purpose, as I said, sort of grew out of its own life in a way, is that I have many Romanians coming to the page because they say that I hold up a sort of a mirror of what is going on in Romania and Bucharest. It's a sort of a cultural mirror. I stay with this purpose sort of humbly because it was not myself who made this purpose. It grew from the magic of life. So those three together forms the Bucharest Lounge. And if I wrap it up, it's because I would like to change the stereotypical views of Romania. That's the whole point of it. So I would like to wrap this up by saying that if you want to change something, usually it's just the first step. The first step. It can be a very, very small step that is needed. And also to collaborate with people who thinks the same as you. And we see it. We see it those weeks, what is going on here in Bucharest and in whole Romania. The first step, we have to have faith. We have to have courage. We need to be dedicated. And we also need to be enduring. So I think the time is now. I think that the traveler who will come to Romania needs to walk gently and leave the place as they found it. And I think that we have traveled to London, Paris, and Rome so many times. It's time to come to Bucharest now. It's time for Bucharest not only to be the top 10, but why not top 3? People started to rediscover Prague. Why not come and discover Bucharest now? It's time. So, I would like to replace the fear and the suspiciousness with some surprise, because people will be surprised when they come here. Wow! The wow, that's what I would like to see. And I think it will happen very soon. Because I think that the time is now for both Bucharest and for Romania to rise to its full potential. Thank you.